Good morning, students. Welcome to our lecture today. So today we'll talk about a very important topic which I'm sure some of you might have heard of, maybe applied in your organization as well. So we'll basically be talking about the resource competency grid. Now this basically becomes the fundamental of a lot of our analysis, a lot of what the company wants to do, how the company intends to achieve its mission statement, because the other word for resource competency grid is basically what we refer to as strategic capability. The stronger the strategic capability of an organization, the better, the more importance it gives to an organization in terms of what it wants to achieve. Now, if we are low on strategic capability, it would mean that we will not be able to pursue a lot of vision statements, a lot of goals that are ambitious, that we feel will give us a leverage for an organization. So let's look at what is strategic capability, why is it so important, how organizations tend to use it. So strategic capability is again a 2x2 grid. So I'll quickly draw the grid for you. So it's a 2x2 grid. Unlike other grids that we've looked at so far, the Boston Consulting Group, the Ansoff Matrix, so it has two components, one of which we call as the resources. So the one element of this grid is resources, as the name suggests, resources. And second is what we refer to as competency. Now very quickly, resources includes tangible as well as intangible. So we talk about men, material, machinery, money, market, all of those as resources. And competency is basically the softer aspect of it. So it is primarily intangible and it includes the skills. So very simple. So we have two elements, resources and competency. Now when we talk of resources, resources can be of two types with any organization. The first one being basic, the second one being unique. And I'll quickly come to what basic means, what unique means. We'll use an example and then we'll look at what it means. When you talk of competencies, competencies basically include your threshold competencies. So that's a nomenclature that is used. And then we also have the core competencies. So these are the competencies. This is basically the resource competency grid that we have, and this is the element which is referred to as strategic capability of an organization. Now when we look at these two components, so I'll quickly circle these, so basic and threshold. So basic resources, threshold competencies, for sake of simplicity, are also referred to as your eligibility criteria, right? Now let me give an example to help you understand. So when you apply for a job, so this is basically done at an organization level, but I'm taking an example at an individual level so that it improves the understandability. So when we apply for a job, there are basic elements of a job description. Now some of them are termed as essential, that you should have communication ability, you should be understanding basic accounting if it is an accounting role, you should be proficient in the use of MS Excel, because that is where you will kind of get a lot of data from and you have to do the analysis. Now any person who's decently good in communication, who understands basic accounting, who can work on Excel, is eligible to apply for that particular role. Now within that particular job description, there will also be elements wherein it will say that there are some preferred or there are some desirable conditions as well. Now let's say somebody says that if you are chartered accountant, you will be preferred over maybe a normal graduate. Let's say if you have expertise in operating SAP, you will be considered over other people who apply for it. Now from an organization perspective, if they have basic resources, again I'll come to examples, and if they have threshold competencies, they are able to, or they are eligible to apply for business, they are eligible to kind of make normal decisions, they are able to kind of implement certain goals that they feel will give the organization a boost. So those are basically referred to as eligibility criteria. Now if I look at from a model perspective, from a framework perspective, the basic resources and the threshold competencies, the defining element of these is they are same as our competitor. they are same as our competitor and they are easy to imitate. So they are also easy to imitate. So same as competitors, easy to imitate. That is what we have when we look at the basic resources and threshold competencies. Now basic resources is normal company, let's say a Genpact has people who are graduates, so that is a basic resource for them to do finance and accounting activities. Threshold competencies, people are able to operate MS Excel, get information, process that and do basic analysis using a lot of functionalities that are available in Excel. So that's what we refer to as basic resources and threshold competencies. Now when we move to the unique and core, when we move to unique and core, so I'm now circling the right part of the grid. So the unique and core are basically elements which give competitive advantage. So CA stands for competitive advantage to organizations. Now let's say a Genpact has people who are graduates. Now Genpact also has people who are data scientists. Now data scientists are very unique resources that are currently available in the market. They're not many in number. If you look at your fraud examiners, they're also very less in number. So organizations which have a very different element, different flavor in terms of resources as compared to their competitors, as compared to their peers, those are referred to as unique resources. Now when we have a data scientist in an organization, that is a resource because resources are tangible. So we're talking of a person who is a data scientist. Now that data scientist will also have a core competency which will be data analytics. Now there is a difference between data analysis and data analytics. So data analytics makes use of a lot of tools, and it is people such as data scientists who bring in that competency. Now when we talk of unique and core, now I'll give you an example. A few years back, Tesco did a study wherein they used the skills of a data scientist, they used the competency of data analytics to understand that what is the buying pattern of people. So they came to a conclusion, they came to a decision that during the Christmas break, during the Christmas period, grandparents do a lot of purchasing for their grandchildren. Now, this is something that without the data analytics capability or without the data scientist, they would not have come to know. And when they did not know about it, they would not have been able to introduce promotional schemes. They would not have been able to introduce new products into the market, which would increase their skills. Now, a regular company, for example, a Walmart, I'm not saying Walmart does not have the capability, but hypothetically, let's assume that Walmart is selling goods regularly from its stores. People come and people buy it. Now Tesco is using the data ability of a data scientist and data analytics to bring elements, to bring differentiators into their business strategy. Now what will happen? During the same Christmas period, maybe Tesco will be able to sell more than what a Walmart does, only because they use data to drive business decisions. Now when they are able to do this, they will be able to increase their sales will be able to increase their profitability. So ultimately Tesco will outperform competition if it was coming from the likes of a Walmart. So unique resources, core competencies give an organization competitive advantage to outperform competition. Now today Tesco has a data scientist. Today, Tesco has a data analytics capability. Now, if that is impacting the business of a Walmart, and that is what Walmart kind of understands, then Walmart will also start hiring data scientists. Walmart will also start building the capability of data analytics. So today, what is differentiator, what is unique, what is core for Tesco in terms of data analytics and a data scientist, tomorrow can be acquired by the Walmart as well. So that is why you see this arrow from unique to basic, from core to threshold. So whatever is unique for an organization today can be acquired by their competitor in the coming future, and that is when unique converts itself into a basic. Now sometimes students ask me a question, can something which is basic become unique? And the answer is an outright no, because whatever is common to everybody, that cannot act as a differentiator for companies to take decisions, for companies to drive their business forward. Now, every company has different unique resources and unique and core competencies. Now, let's take the example of Apple. Apple's core competency is the R&D capability. But when it comes to Samsung, their core competency is more around marketing. So, whereas Apple will invest a lot into R&D to give itself the competitive advantage over peers, Samsung will invest a lot into marketing to give itself an advantage over their competitors. Now, who wins or who loses, that is something for the customer to decide, that is something for the product to decide. But what they are trying to say here is, every company needs to invest time, money, effort to be able to derive unique resources and core competencies which will act as a differentiator. So when we said that basic resources and threshold competencies are same as our competitor and easy to imitate, everybody would have it, or even if they don't have it, it will not take them a lot of time to acquire those resources or competencies. But when we come to unique and core, that is when we say that these are different to our competitors. I use some short form, different to our competitors and difficult to imitate. Now keep in mind that the word is difficult, the word is not impossible. So whatever you have today can be acquired by your competitors tomorrow, and that is when it becomes basic and threshold. So if a company has to succeed, if a company has to grow, if the company has to outperform competition, they have to consistently invest in the unique resource development and the core competency development. Likewise, there are other examples that we want to take. So Coca-Cola has a very strong networking ability, has a very strong network where through which it sells its products. So again, Coca-Cola has a superiority over when it comes to Pepsi in terms of reaching out to people with their particular products. There could be other examples. For example, when we talk of Google, so Google has a lot of unique resources and core competencies which make it a innovation company. And innovation companies are companies which are driving the market forward. They're not driven by the market, but they're trying to drive the market forward. Sometimes companies start the development of capability building after they've realized that if they don't do it, they might go out of business, like the case of Honda. So Honda was always into petrol cars. Their core competency to develop diesel engines were not there. They did not have the research and development facilities to develop diesel engines. But that is something that they realized, that this was trying to take away their market share to other competitors, because people were preferring maybe diesel cars over petrol cars, especially when it comes to India. So today Honda has acquired the capability, the core competency to develop diesel cars as well. Now if you look at Honda and its peers, everybody has the capability to develop diesel cars, so that becomes threshold. But tomorrow, if you have to come up with a hybrid engine, or if you come up with a more fuel efficient engine which is not there with other competitors as well, that is what will give the competitive advantage. So again, to reiterate, resource competency grid, sometimes it is also called as the RC grid, is also referred to as strategic capability. And if I kind of take you back to our strategic planning process, we said that before you implement your strategic choice, which could be your BCG, which could be your ANSOR, which could be your Porter's generic strategies, there has to be a litmus test. And one of the litmus test elements was feasibility. Feasibility was the ability to implement or drive the chosen strategic choice. So that is where the strategic capability comes into picture. So if you have strategic capability, it drives feasibility. And if you're able to drive feasibility and pass the litmus test, that is one of the elements which will make it more sustainable for the organization in the longer run. So I hope you found this useful. I hope it is now clear in terms of why resource competency grid is important and how it acts as a differentiator to growing and successful organizations. Thank you so much.